I'm Liza Mundy. I'm director of our Breadwinning and Caregiving program here at New America. Thank you so much for coming, and thank you so much for staying for our panel. The discussion of this panel is going to pick up on a question that was actually raised earlier, in that how do you push change in workplaces that have historically been inflexible and or resistant to moving women to the top? I think those two things are related. And how do you bring change to workplaces that, in some cases, for new reasons, are creating work-life challenges for workers at all income levels, including lower income and middle income workers in sectors that are changing and evolving? It's my hope that we'll have a robust discussion. I'm perfectly prepared to moderate an argument if it turns into a polite argument. And so for that purpose, I'm going to introduce everybody now with the hope that people feel like they can chime in when somebody responds. I do have specific questions for everybody here, but feel free to jump in even before I've addressed you or asked a specific question. So Barbara Byrne is a vice chairman in the banking division at Barclays, which recently celebrated its 325th birthday, I think you told me earlier. She is responsible for leading the firm's global relationships with multinational corporate clients. Barbara has over 30 years of financial services experience. For the past 4 years, she was ranked by American Banker as one of the 25 most powerful women in finance. She also told me earlier that she's had 2 days off this year. And she is a member of the Breadwinning and Caregiving Programs Advisory Council, and we're very grateful for that. And we're very grateful to you for coming down to Washington today.
And she has four phenomenal kids.
Yeah, let's just.
Since this is a panel.
Right.
And a husband.
Yes,
and a dog.
Yes, that's right. Maria Simon is a partner at the Geller Group and specializes in business law and litigation. She also spearheads the firm's wills and trust practice and its divorce and family law practice, areas of the law that go hand in hand protecting families during stressful times. Your firm was the focus of a really interesting New York Times article about innovative ways in which you're changing the workplace and the practice of law, and we'll talk about that at length, hopefully. Carol Joyner is the director for the Labor Project for Working Families in partnership with Family Values at Work, and works to evolve workplace standards in collective bargaining and public policy. Carol is also the founding director of the 1199 SEIU Employer Child Care Fund and past president of the Child Care Corporation. And I think it's fair to say, Emery, that you need no introduction at this point, but thank you so much for being on the panel. And actually, before we get into the question of institutional change and how we bring about changes in both specific corporations and firms, but also fields. One of the things I noticed in the past panel is that the phrase having it all comes up a lot now in conversation. And I happen to know that you're hoping in your book and the conversation that follows your book to actually get away from the phrase having it all. And I thought I might at least give you the chance to say why.
Okay, thank you. Yes. As many of you know, the article I wrote in The Atlantic in 2012 was called Why Women Still Can't Have It All. And it was not my choice of title. I actually wanted to call it Why Women Can't Have It All, ... because my point was, here are the changes we still need to make. The Atlantic thought that that sounded too much like the end of men, and they'd already pointed had an article on the end of men, and anyway, so we ended up with this title, which now means pretty much wherever I go, I'm often introduced as, this is Anne-Marie Slaughter who thinks women can't have it all, which is exactly the opposite of what I think I stand for, but there it is. But more importantly, having it all comes from Helen Gurley Brown, the editor of Cosmo, who wrote a memoir in the early 80s about having it all, and it was a kind of self-consciously elite, wealthy, you can have it all. You know, if you think about Cosmo, this sort of the perfect woman. I didn't know that. I grew up with the idea that having it all meant you had a career and a family too. It was that women could have what men had, which was a career and a family too. But I have since been convinced, A, that it has no legitimate feminist pedigree, but more importantly, that it is exclusive in all the ways we've just heard, that the idea of having it all for people who have barely enough to either feed themselves or maintain their families or hold on to their jobs, that frame is exactly counter to the conversation we're trying to have here. Point one. And point two, it's just too easy to caricature. Right? And so people are always in that. The other thing that happens when I get introduced is, this is Anne-Marie Slaughter, and they go through the many blessings that I do have and say, and she says women can't have it all. Well, she looks pretty good to me. It's just too easy to caricature as a kind of selfish, grabby thing, which is particularly bad for women, right? I mean, that is not where we want to go. So I think we really ought to be moving away from the term. It is not in my book, except to explain why I don't like it. It is nowhere near the title, and I do think we could happily consign it to Helen Gurley Brown's history.
Great, okay. So thanks, editors,
not
right?
Not that I think thanks. That will happen.
Thanks, headline writers. Yes. Great, okay, that's wonderful. And so, Barbara, let's start talking about the field of finance. I've been really curious to know what thoughts have been going through
yeah,
your head
me
as
too.
You've listened to our conversations so far. Finance is a field that has traditionally been tough for women at the top. It's a very, very high-powered, competitive field.
Yes.
And I just wonder whether you think it's naive for us to be talking about bringing work-life balance and flexible schedules and relax and peace and happiness and everything to workers in the finance industry, or whether there are changes that
I'm
can
not sure
be made.
Peace and happiness. Okay. But I would say flexibility is essential. So it's interesting, as I listen to this conversation, it mirrors what I see in the industry. Yes, I'm in finance. I've actually been an investment banker for 35 years. I am frontline. The reason why I haven't had much time this year is I do mergers and acquisitions. And in case you haven't noticed, it happens to be, everybody seems to be buying everybody else. Very quickly, it's a lot like being an emergency room physician. When the patient shows up, you have to deal with it. So it comes in waves. When you talk about our industry in particular, we care a lot about to have the flex because the burn rate is so high. It's like being an athlete, that you've got to be able to have downtime. So even though you might think of finance as not being flexible, I sit here before you as someone who in 1991, after I had my second child, was told, you know, we really need to make sure, this was by a very progressive guy by the name of Tom Hill, who's now at Blackstone, has been there for a while, who said, you know, my wife was at Sally after our second child. She's got burnt out. How about you work from home on Fridays? I'll set you up. You'll be down in Princeton. So you've got the ability. I trust you. Note that word trust, because this was being done back in those days on an individual basis. Oh, we trust you, Barbara. You know, you can work from home on Fridays. My view, quite frankly, was if the guys could be on a golf course, I could be anywhere. At least I'd have a phone. They didn't have cell phones back then. They also, the other thing is, I got the first paid maternity leave ever. I was at Lehman Brothers, a firm you may have heard of. And so at Lehman Brothers, and in 1987, my first child, Megan, you know, Megan was born, I was pregnant with her. And they had just said to me, well, we don't have maternity leave. We have 6 weeks disability pay. And we don't have that. And I go, well, wait a minute. Ralph Schlosstein, who, by the way, is CEO of Evercore, was a classmate of mine. I said, Ralph's just been out. I said, he was on a client junket, and he had hepatitis. He was out, like, because he was yellow for 3 months. And I am producing a future taxpayer. It really seems to me that I should have maternity. So they created a three-month policy. We go to a four-month policy. Let's flash forward to where we are now. I now work for a British bank, which, by the way, European companies are far more progressive on these issues. It's very interesting. We have 4 months maternity leave in the United States, but we have up to a year off in the UK. Right? And it's done at a different, your job, you don't get full pay that whole time, but the government picks up some policy as well, and then you come back. But because you have this real sincere interest in creating that flexibility, and technology has enabled it, you can really push the discussion forward. We have just started something about 2 months ago called dynamic working. It's a dynamic working campaign. You can sign up to be an ambassador for them. What does that mean? And we've encouraged the creativity of how to have dynamic working. And that can include gosh, I'm in the Army and I need to be out. I've gone out and hired people who are actually in ROTC.
It's my phone, but it'll stop.
It's eventually. And bringing those folks in, whether you need time off to care for parents, all of those things, that dynamic working is important. You're still, though, in a really competitive industry, and you have to fight it almost every single day, and you have to call it out. And women bring, if they can survive through the periods of you know, by having this flexibility in their career in their 30s and 40s, they really emerge as a voice of wisdom in the room. Oftentimes, I am the only woman in the room, and people are quite intense. They're very competitive. People who individually on their own wouldn't be that way. When you get them in a group, it's really interesting. It's like boys in a sandbox when they're four. And you have to sort of call out rules. And I do think now's the time to be asking for these things. And you don't get penalized for it. I was not penalized for it. You know, people say, well, how could you have done that? I went, well, I asked for it. I got it. I was trusted. You know, how do you create institutional trust in your people? And you have the great gift right now, and we haven't spoken a lot about it today, of the millennial generation. I consider them a gift. Yeah. They are a gift because they think differently. And they don't accept no for an answer. Mm-hmm. And quite frankly, in a competitive environment, don't take no for an answer. It's the only thing that's respected, is the no for an answer. They want the tension. They want the fights. I don't accept that. We need something different, something better. And the only other thing of everything I've heard challenged today that I would challenge is be careful with the word privileged. It's turned into this sort of catchwork of privilege. What is privilege? We're all privileged. We're here in the United States, having been over in Zambia and other places. So I just think be careful with that word. And I say that as somebody who actually grew up in a single-parent family. My dad died when I was young. My mother never went to high school, and I started work when I was 10. There's never been a woman in my family who has not worked and worked in factories or on farms. So I think it's really careful. You have to be really careful about how you think about what that word is.
In the sense that you think that people are too defensive?
I think people use it as a catch-all to otherize people. It's like the word 1%. There's always a 1%. It's math. The issue is, what does that mean? You know, should we demonize people? How do we get the lift? How do we make sure that those, you know, I have two big issues. I care a lot about reforming prisons. We have too many people that are in prison. I care a tremendous amount about that. And we're actually doing a program with that for education. And I care an awful lot about student loans, which is in the finance sector, and how do you make sure that I was a full scholarship student. How do you make sure that next generation is there? And then somebody actually talked about, one last thing, is hiring people without 4-year degrees. We're doing that. And we started an apprenticeship program. And how do you think about bringing in unconventional talent? The technology industry does it all the time, but they're bringing this very high-end kind of capability. How do you bring in people out of the local community colleges and get them to a point and then help pay for their education and move them further? We started an apprenticeship program. In the government, it's interesting. They have a lot of restrictions on us into what we can and cannot do. And that's a whole separate subject, but we are on that.
Great. Well, we'll come back to all of these issues. Carol, I wonder if you would just comment on, you know, we talked a little bit about changes in the economy, that this is a big year for mergers and acquisitions, and the way in which putting out those fires or responding to those emergencies has affected your schedule. What are you seeing in terms of the workplace communities who you represent or pay attention to? There was a piece in the Post today, actually, about the fact that companies more and more, in lieu of offering wage increases, are offering a couple of days of, you know, paid family leave. And I was reading it thinking, wondering how to feel about that. I mean, does it have to be breadwinning or caregiving? Like, you can't have both?
So I just want to respond before I answer your question to the 1% statement.
Yeah.
I think that when we started really hearing about the 1% and distinguishing the 1% from the 99%, that was at the point of the economic meltdown. And I think that what it's done for the society is to say that we've sort of uncovered that there is a significant economic inequity in this country. And while we don't, while I think it's a mistake to create a catch-all term that after a while is meaningless, I think that focusing on a population of people who have a significant amount of wealth, and being able to say, well, compared to this bottom 30%, you have 1% earning almost the same as the bottom 30% in this country, is an important conversation that drives the policy conversation, that drives the work-family conversation, that helps us to, you know, the woman who was speaking just before this talk about, well, you know, what happens to those people who can't get jobs, who can't ramp on to our society, and is there an inequity? It gave meaning to that conversation, and I don't think it was, I don't know, and I think maybe for many people it was intended to find the bad person, right, or the group of people causing the problems in America, but I think the conversation was more about, we have many problems in America, our economic problems are around inequality, and how do we begin to talk about that? So having to say that in response, and I'd love to, you know, what you think about that as a frame for at least identifying where our weaknesses are as an economy, you know, an economy where everyone should have what they need to get by. I don't know about having it all, I agree with you, but certainly we don't want a situation where people are losing it all either, right? So to your question, about you know, what I see with the people that I represent and who I work with. As was said earlier, I'm with the Labor Project for Working Families, and we work in partnership with Family Values at Work. The Labor Project is a 20-year-old organization based originally in California that worked to sort of address work and family issues. And we looked particularly at unions because they had for many, many years negotiated and pushed forward fair work practices through their contract negotiations and through their organizing. But we also knew that some of those wonderful things like an 8-hour day, a living wage, you know, some of those policies were slipping away from the average American. And we wanted to figure out how to have a conversation and think about the policies that unions had worked on and bring those to the broader public. So what came out of the work that we did when I was actually not at the Labor Project, at that point I was on the board of the Labor Project, but when the work that we did that was really important was the first paid family leave bill in California got passed because of the Labor Project for Working Families and its close tie to the California State Federation of Labor. And from then, we began to look at other ways of using public policy and collective bargaining to you know, sort of give people a chance, a fair shot at putting food on the table, having a job that they can return to even if their child was sick the next day, the earlier day, and being able to really make things happen for people who, for whom, you know, nothing was happening. They couldn't move up in the job. They couldn't take off a day of work. Where we are now, and then meanwhile, while we were doing that work under the Labor Project for Working Families, Family Values at Work got developed as a way to say there are different organizations and groups around the country trying to do the same thing. How do we pool resources? How do we pool, get economies of scale so that we can do this for more people? And so Family Values at Work is a network of 21 state coalitions working on paid leave, paid sick days, and supporting the efforts around fair scheduling that was mentioned earlier, and pregnancy accommodation. And now we're really, really keen and focused on this overtime regulations change that was just introduced about a few weeks ago. And so the idea of it was that somewhere, you know, we look at Europe. You mentioned, you know, the year off in Britain, the 3 years if both couples, both partners or parents take the time off in Sweden, and many other countries that are able to offer these services and offer these benefits to workers. And then we look at the United States and the lack of support that we've had. What we've done in terms of winning paid sick days campaigns and working with a diverse and broad coalitions around the country is that 3 years ago, there were only a handful of people subject to the employer's whim who had paid sick days, right? A handful of corporations were providing it. The percentages were low. Over the last 3 years since the your article was written,
10 million people now have access to paid sick days who didn't have it before, who can actually, you know, say to their employer, well, I'm not feeling well today, I need to take the day off, and they can actually return to their job. They're not being fired. We're expecting numbers to come out, I think, any day. Maybe they came out yesterday on how the percentage of people with access to paid sick days is going up because of some of these efforts. One of the stories I like to tell, that just to compare sort of the experience, is that there is a woman in Maryland who, you know, she has three kids working at a Target. You know, she woke up, scratchy throat. One of the children had been sick, so she figured, well, you know that feeling, I've got it now too. And she wanted to call into work, but she realized that she had no time available whatsoever. They don't have paid sick days at her job, and she couldn't, like, risk again calling in because she was probably going to lose her job. She had to call a boss anyway because her child had to stay home. And they actually cried on the phone together because there was nothing that he could do to help her as the manager because she was out of time. And there was nothing that she could do because she knew that probably when she went back to work the next time she would be fired by HR. And, I mean, that's a situation. You can compare that to Aaron in Oregon, in Portland, Oregon, who woke up feeling the same way, not feeling well, feeling like, God, I think I need to call in. And then it dawned on her, we have paid sick days in the state. You know, she called her employer. She said, I'm not feeling well today. I can't come in. Turned over. And 2 days later, she was back at work. She was fine. And I think we need to get to a higher standard of how we treat employees, what we expect from our society about this work. As a result, and I don't want to go too long because I know there are other issues to talk about, but when I first started doing this work with Family Values at Work and the Labor Project more directly 5 years ago, we had about 700 coalition partners around the country. Now we have more than 2,000 just under the Family Values at Work umbrella and the Labor Project umbrella. And at the same time, we also have a significant number of other organizations that are gravitating their interest to this work, to paid leave, paid sick days, scheduling, pregnancy accommodation, because they see that we've got to figure out how to address caregiving and working in America. It doesn't have to be either or, and it shouldn't just be for people who, you know, are middle class or upper middle class and have jobs that, you know, they're considered essential. It should be for everyone. I'm going to stop right there. Yep.
And just to pick up on one of the things that you said about California, mm-hmm. for people, I think this is what you're talking about. California is one of the few states, still one of the few states, yep. that has a paid family leave program where if you're becoming a parent, male, if you're male or female, or somebody in your family needs caregiving, workers in the state pay money into a fund mm-hmm. and are entitled to get paid family leave. It doesn't come from their workplace. It doesn't come from their employer. It comes from the money that they've paid into this state fund, similar to disability or unemployment. And I think one of the questions of the moving into this so-called gig economy, where apparently everybody's going to be an Uber driver someday, is whether that sort of change in our workforce and the way that people work, whether we're moving into this gig economy, whether that will create pressure for more and more states, or even the federal government, to create something like this, where your benefits are not dependent on whether you work for Barclays or whether you work for Lehman Brothers or whether you work for Macy's, but will come from someplace other than your employer, and we could talk about whether or not we are moving into that world. Maria, I just wondered if you could talk a little bit about the really interesting, I mean, we talked about finance. The law is a really interesting field right now because there are so many changes taking place in the law anyway. If you can talk about some of the truly innovative practices that you brought to your firm and how, and the reaction you've gotten since the Times mm-hmm. did a piece on it.
Yeah, absolutely.
We met on Twitter.
Thank you again for having me. What we've tried to do at the Geller Law Group is to put into place harness all of the technology that we have available to us, and because we trust, as we've talked about before, trust our employees to do good work, to utilize that to emphasize the philosophy of work-life balance. I know that is such a catchphrase, this work-life balance, but how can we really have interesting careers and still be there for, you know, birthday celebrations at school without feeling the that pull of, I should be at the office, I need to have this FaceTime. I know at my previous, I mean, and lawyers have it so that part of our entire billing structure is billable hours. That is it. This is our revenue, this is how we generate it. It is totally based on how many hours you are working. So it's actually, while there has been this component that you had to be in the office, you had to be visible by the senior partner, by removing that FaceTime component, we've set that structure in its old form completely into a new category. Because what we've done is we've said, all right, we can do a billable hour requirement still. We're still based on this billing generating revenue, but we're trusting our employees to get it done from home or wherever else they need to be. I know my paralegal's here today. I mean, it's not just for lawyers, it's for our admin staff as well, so that we can have that kind of flexibility throughout throughout our staff. And so
there is actually no physical workplace,
there is no
right?
physical workplace. Right. What we do is we utilize a virtual office, and we have a base. We happen to be based out in Fairfax. I live in the district. It's a great commute, let me tell you. Love it. And I go out there probably about 2 days a week. And then we can utilize, based on the way we've structured our lease, we can utilize a space in DC. And I'm there probably 1 to 2 days a week as well, because I have a lot of clients in the district. And then I get to work from home. So, you know, this week is a great example of the fact that not having to go into an office is wonderful. My son does not have any childcare this week. So, none. So by, you know, some good
summer, right?
Yeah, it's
right.
summer. This is the one week that right. nothing right. could get scheduled. So, you know, he's been at a friend's house for a few days. Thank you. Yeah. Yesterday we had he was with me. I somehow billed 9 hours yesterday, but he was with
wow.
me.
How old was he?
4. I actually, my wow, whole shoulder amazing. Is covered in snot right now, because he decided that, why couldn't we hang out again today? We went to the zoo yesterday. Why did I have to go to work today?
Right. The more you give, the more threat. You don't get any credit for
no.
what you did yesterday.
I was like, we went to
why can't we do today what you did?
Exactly. I was like, well, we can do it again tomorrow, because that's how I've set up the week. And he's like, no. What? Anyway, it's good I'm wearing a jacket. But this is just part of our daily life. I mean, my law partner and I, we're both in our mid-30s. We're in the slog of it. We know that if we can put our heads down and really right. focus right. on our careers, we can make this wonderful law practice that can be sustainable into our old age. And that's, we have a lot of these pep talks between the two of us over GChat about, you know, okay, we can do it. All right, this is what's going on. Okay, this is what the revenues come in. I mean, we have these kind of pep talks between ourselves. We know that this is what we need to do. But we also recognize that we all have young children. My entire firm actually just happens to be comprised of women. That's not a thing that we were purposely trying. It just so happens who we've hired. And all of the women who do have children, they're all under the age of 5. I mean, I mentioned my paralegal, Crystal, who's
nice
here.
Lady.
Her son was out for the last few weeks, or she was out because he had 104 fever. I mean, I don't want to penalize Crystal at all, because I know that what the work that did need to get done, she got done when he was napping or later at night, because I trust her to do the job and I trust all of my staff. And that's something that I think we have to implement in some way. And I realize that we're very fortunate because we are lawyers and we were able to create our own business model in this. But unfortunately, we shouldn't be novel and we shouldn't be interesting enough that the New York Times is following me around for the day, which, by the way, was kind of an interesting process. And they left right as my dog started to vomit, and that's when I thought, all right, now you really, right? They were there with me.
Right.
They were with me for 12 hours. They're like, well, what do you do now to get your son to calm down for the day? I was like, I need you to leave. That's what I need you to do. You have been with me.
But is there a trade-off? I mean, you mentioned the fact that that it's all women at your office. Are there men, for example, who don't necessarily who would like to come into an office, or women who
absolutely.
Would like to come into an office and would like that sort of formal FaceTime and
absolutely. And I think that it works for us because we are all very type A and motivated to do good work in a short time. I don't think it would. I don't try to say that this needs to work for everybody, but I think it has to be an option for the type of worker who it can really capitalize on it, because it should not be a one-fits-all structure if you don't need it to be. Again, I realize that this does not fit for every single type of job. That we've created this kind of we've created a work environment to let it happen.
So one thing that you said that is really interesting. You don't have any base, right? Any, because here, obviously, I work from planes, trains, home.
Multidimensional, is my sense.
But I'm not. I mean, I'm in this office on a good week, 2.5 mm-hmm. days, and many weeks I'm, you know, on a trip, and then one day at home, and one day. But one of the things we've discovered, and this goes back to class issues and income issues, is if you put in place, you can work from wherever, and you have a physical base, what that means is the people who are the equivalent of the lawyers or the partners, the non-admin staff, work from wherever, because their job is wherever their computer is. Our wonderful receptionists can't really do that, right? The desk is sitting there. And if you're in HR, part of being in HR is people need to be able to come and see you.
Right.
And then if you're in finance, and so then you get a two-tiered system.
Yeah.
And that has been, that's really been an issue, and one that is very much part of this discussion, where my instinct is always to say, yes, of course, if you can work from home, absolutely. And then I find there's still some physically anchored jobs. And not only that, the people who are there are more resentful, and it's also lonelier, right? On a Friday when everybody decides they'll work from home, who's there? So
there's also, you can't have everybody in my industry working from home. Your traders have to be on the trading desk. You're supervising risk. So, you know, we would have, want to see the world blow up? Try that. So what you need to be able to do is to give flexibility in other ways. So, you know, perhaps we'll do a job share for a period of time.
Yes.
Where somebody works Monday through Wednesday. We do this a lot. Monday through Wednesday, someone else works Wednesday through Friday. So we can create, you know, that period of time. You talked earlier about, Anne-Marie, about, you know, people who take time off, how do they get back in? The biggest problem isn't in the staff positions. People can move in and out of staff even if they've been off for a couple of years. It's the line positions.
Yep.
And the line is where the power is, because it's where the money is made. It's
can
the
you
revenue.
Explain what that what a
to
line
be in a
is.
Line position, you're effectively think of about as being in sales. You're either in sales or you're a trader. You're the person who actually is responsible for the relationships that generates the revenue. So, you know, people say to me, is there discrimination there? I went, no. If you're a 2-foot-tall purple midget, you bring in $100 million, they'll build a statue to you in the lobby and bow to it every day as they come in. It is that there is, it's really about commercial. How do you go about doing that? And to become that officer, you know, that's the hardest thing to take. I have young women, they'll go offline. They're really phenomenal. They're 10 years in the business, about to make managing director. They've had their second child. They have one right now. I need her to go back into the line function in 2 or 3 years. I have to get her into a position right now that's staff, but close enough to the line so I can get her back in. Because if I get her too far back, I can't get her back in. So it's, and you know, so I can move her up. And in order to change it, the industry such as I'm in, you need to have women at the top of the organization who said, we need to do this now. We need to make these changes, and I insist upon it. And that woman has to be a woman who's front line, who has revenue impact, because that is what it's like being in the NFL. You're going to have to be a player on the field. So you want those women out there as really strong advocates and pushing for it. And you're beginning to see pieces of that. If you look at these organizations, they're changing in some ways. In some ways, they feel like it's 1962. But in others, it is changing, the type of flexibility and the questions that you can raise. Half the reason I'm still doing this, and I'll be 61 in 3 weeks, is I'm not leaving until we get it the way that it needs to be. I have 3 daughters, 1 son. It's for all of them that you sort of say, I have the voice, I have the ability, I can get to effective change, because all these guys have wives and daughters, and they all care about the same thing.
Yeah.
So they really do. So you just have to put it out there, and I have the ability to do it, so I do it.
Well, and as someone in her mid-30s, this is a conversation that I have on a daily basis with my friends. I mean, this is where we are, whether it be male, female, we are all in this kind of slog. And I have friends, males, who might, their wives are Ivy League educated lawyers who have taken a step back, and now they're sent, you know, the husband is going on, he's like, I can see partner, it's right there. It's like, if I put my head down for 2 years, I've got it. And the wife is like, it is just as brilliant as him, or even more so, usually. And she's taken some time off, there's 2 kids, and she's like, how do I get back into it now? And so it's, you know, that's just where we are, and I can understand. It's so great to hear other people saying that we're there to help, because I know that I felt like there was no one there for me to follow.
In many ways, the crisis of 08 caused a lot of the programs that were put in place in 04 through 06, which are on-ramps and off-ramps, creating the ability to get back in away. Those are coming back right now, because the shortage of talent is the economy. You may not be feeling it yet, but you should be, that the economy is beginning to take off, the number of jobs that are available and the shortage of skills. It's when you get to that environment, you go, okay, where are we going to get the next generation? How do we think outside the box about where we find these people? And a big piece of that will be going back to very much those women, those people in their mid-30s, because my argument has always been, let's take somebody back at 45, they'll give us a good 20 years.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
and as opposed to somebody who comes for two, you know, and or three. So it's, and I think you'll see that coming back, and we actually don't have it just for women. It's because there are many men who've had to go off and take care of parents in situations like that.
I mean, I think all of that is extremely important, and what I would say, the people that we're building policy structures for, the women and men who are beginning to show leadership and develop inside of communities to move public policy and to move workplace standards for themselves, who don't have, who really are not part of the conversation. What I would say is that we talked about the person at the desk and the receptionist and the HR person. There are people working at McDonald's and in home care industry, on farms, and they literally have to show up every single day. There's not even a discussion about trying to figure out, how do we make work more flexible for you? How do we create a greater work-life balance for you? There's no conversation happening in that realm. And they're also, it's also harder to do for some of the reasons we already talked about, because if you're working, like the woman I mentioned in Target, she's at that register, you know? And unless we plan to automate every single thing, you literally need to have people who are hands-on doing work. If you're a home health aide, you have to be there. You have to be there to show up. And so I don't think, though, that we have been creative enough in this society to say, well, how do we create structures for all workers that afford them a modicum of work-life balance? And maybe it's about hiring more people than you actually need instead of fewer, which is the trend,
right.
More people than you actually need, so that people can do more job sharing. People can actually be able to look at their schedule across a week with one or two other people and say, well, how do we get our needs met and get benefits and be able to put food on the table and bring home a decent wage? We need like the brain power that's happening on Wall Street around making change happen and building and mergers and acquisitions. We need that brain power to come into the conversation and help us think through how everyone in this country can have a sense of stability in their families and productivity and stability on the job. And so while we have a growing movement, people working on all sorts of work and family policies, paid leave, paid sick days, fair scheduling, pregnancy accommodation, we've gotten quite a few lawyers involved in the conversation, especially around pregnancy accommodation, because of recent high-profile lawsuits and because of some of the issues related to the legal issues related to that. But what we don't have is the group of people that matches the polling. So the polling data says that, for the most part, regardless of party identity, regardless of socioeconomic background, regardless of class or whatever, that most people in this country, with like 70-80% of the people in this country, feel that we should have access to paid family leave and paid sick days, and that they'll vote for a candidate who talked about these issues. I mean, there's enough polling data to suggest that. However, on the ground, we don't really see the reality of that. We don't see those policies coming to fruition fast enough. We don't see the business sector engaging in these policies for everyone as opposed to just for themselves. And so my challenge today to everybody in this room is to, while we're making progress, significant progress, We're changing the frame from, you know, an individual problem to a societal problem. We have worked on changing that frame around these work-family issues. What we really need to see is sort of the power in this country begin to really look at these issues and take them on in a strategic, thoughtful way that affects both culture, as was mentioned earlier, and policy.
Can I?
Yeah.
So thank you for that, and I agree. One way I know to sort of creative that it has been, is I think Macy's does this, and at least one other large, kind of more retail oriented does this, which is it allows self-scheduling, mm-hmm. right? Where here's your number of hours a week, and of course most people want a certain number, right? But you can schedule it when you want to do it by using that same software. Right. That allows
that Starbucks is using right now.
You can use it to either minimize people's hours, or you can let them step in for each other. So it's informal job sharing, right? It's saying I have to be out on Wednesday because I need to go to the doctor because my kid, is in a school play because whatever it is. Can you fill in for me then? And so you create either people who know each other or people who don't know each other. If you can do this with Uber, you can do this with people's hours. And from the employer's point of view, what they just need are the hours covered. So that's just as one example, I think, where you can set it and you say, this is how many hours, you decide when you're going to work it and get the software solution. That's one point. A second point, and this just builds on something Barbara said about millennials are really helping, because millennials, I tell the story in my book, and I don't know if Hannah's here, but if she is, I'll embarrass her again. But I hired her when she was 22 and she's right out of college and she started working for me and she left at 6 o'clock, even when I was still sitting there. And I'm like, I'm still here, right? So, and she would leave and she plays rugby and her rugby practice was at 6:30. And so at 6 o'clock, she'd put in the days where she'd leave. And I kept thinking, God, this is really something. And after a while, in the first place, she always got her work done, right? There's no question. She always got her work done. She was online very soon after. I never complained. And after a while, I started thinking, what is the matter with me that I'm still sitting here at 6 o'clock? Like, how come she can go work out and I can't? Like, why am I not managing my time efficiently enough? So millennials, I think, are pushing. The other thing that is pushing are elders, right? And Barbara and my generation, we're the baby boom generation, and we are becoming the elder boom, right? I mean, same number of people, obviously. Some of us have died along the way, but overall, we're still here. It's a big bulge. And what you're seeing, most of those people cannot afford to retire. This, again, we move from defined benefit to defined contribution along the way. That even those of us who have the money and should know better are not putting enough away, much less the people who don't have the money or the advantage of counseling. As people get older, they're going to want, and whether it's in lawyering or banking or in any level, they're going to start saying, I want to work more flexibly. Right? I want to work fewer hours. So you're seeing a push from younger people and older people for the sort of things that parents or caregivers more generally
I just want to add to that,
along.
And from men.
Yes,
because men, regardless, mainly pushed by millennials, but also men are starting to say, all over the world, I should be part of this caregiving, yes. And society has kept me out of it, and it's really right. Important for me to be a part of it.
Yep.
So
absolutely.
I would add them as another group.
And just the last thing, I totally agree, and the last thing I would just say on this sort of question we've been talking about, I think there are two concepts I've found helpful. One is as an individual thinking about your career. So this is if you're in your mid-30s, the people you're counseling, is to think about your career in terms of interval training, right? So if you're an athlete, you know that going really hard and then slowing down and going really hard again is how you get into peak condition. I think the same is true for your work life. Over a career. In other words, there are periods, I came out of college and I worked really hard for a while. I started as a law professor. I had to get tenure. I pulled plenty of all-nighters, right? And I was not yet married and I didn't have kids. Basically I would work all week and I would see my then boyfriend, now husband, on weekends. And then, of course, I hit the next 5 years where I spent 5 years trying to have children. and succeeded. And so that period, you know, I wasn't writing as many articles, right? There just was no way. I was, from the work point of view, I was slowing down. And then I became a dean and I really went at it. And then I pulled back again. If you're talking about long careers and careers in multiple jobs, which is what we're talking about, certainly for millennials, thinking about it just as Barbara said, like this woman you're talking to, she can pull back. She can't pull back forever, right? Forget it. She can't pull back, and she may not even be able to pull back for 5 years, but three, she can probably pull back.
The other thing to think about, and this is how I did it, because I'm always asked, is to build teams, yes. Really loyal teams of people. So, and you have to, and then the word that will flow through everything we're talking about is trust. You build trusted teams of people, you bring them with you, you support them, I pay them handsomely. Okay, people ask me, how did I raise four kids? You ought to see my nanny and housekeeper. They are well paid. And it is
with full
benefits, time off, you need it, I give you free miles, go on vacation, go to Europe, do what you need to do. It is because, you know, I have a lot of people who are buying fancy antiques. I thought, you know, I think I'd rather have my children better cared for and they can eat off of a folding table. It didn't matter, but you have to think about the teams of people you put in place. You have teams at home. You have teams at the office. You have teams you care about. This young woman is a member of my team. I am going to take care of her. She's going to make it, right? If I have to knock some people over, and I'm not afraid of doing that. And it is so, but I think you have to think about much broader than just yourself and bring those people with you. And when you stumble, which you will, because I do it every day, they're going to be there for you. They're going to pick you up. And so they're going to pull you through when you have those times, and that's how you get through all of it and the peak conditioning, at least from where I sit in my perspective.
I was just intrigued by your team is you and your partner coaching each other through every day, which I think is really interesting also.
And we also have staff. I mean, I have three associates under me that I'm supervising, but bringing along. And one of the best things that one of my associates has ever said to me is that she knows that she can be at this job forever. She does not have to think about, well, what will be the step when I want to have children? She's a newlywed. I know that it's on her mind. I know that it's on her mind because she talks to me way too much about strollers. it's something I want to see her succeed. I want to see these people succeed because it benefits me in the long run. It benefits them. There's no reason to try to push someone down.
All right, so let me open it up to questions.
Just introduce yourself.
Yeah. Oh. And try to keep them short and make them questions, because so everybody can get to it, yeah.
I'm Valerie Young with Momentum. Issues of care are fundamentally all economic issues, and they occur in every life and in every demographic group and in every sector of the workforce. The things that really worry me are that U.S. Women's labor force participation has been flat for 20 years, and it's significantly lower than in most or many other countries, specifically Europe and other places, and that we invest so little in early childhood education, and that's where you have the real economic gains in your human capacity. How can we hope to hold on to our position in the world if we have allowed so many other countries to outpace us so significantly in terms of being able to mobilize half of their population in the workforce, and understanding that investment in care is economic development?
Who wants to take that?
I'll start off. I'm a district resident. We have universal preschool for three-year-olds. That has been a phenomenal boon to me. My son is in school, and except for right now, this week, all year round, actually, at the charter school that he goes to in the district, which is phenomenal.
How many hours is that?
He can go, I mean, free of charge from 8:15 to 3:45 every day, and then there's aftercare or before care, which is extremely nominal. I've had the full-time nanny who left, and he was part of my team, and he was paid very, very handsomely. But now we're doing aftercare, and it's very affordable. And if you can't afford it, then it's free. I'm gladly willing to pay for it because I have the means to do so. But if it's helpful like that, it's those kind of things where I see the parents dropping off are of all different socioeconomic means because it's a public school in DC, And the fact that we know that there is a child care or a good place to leave your child, that they're getting a great education, is something. And it's unfortunate that it's not earlier, because
for
0 to 3 is what I mean, not earlier, but like for younger students.
not
6 a.m. But that's something, it's the care. And so you can see parents going back to work when their child hits that, because they have the ability to be there.
To your point, I think that there are pockets of model situations in this country. Communities that have figured out caregiving early childhood education, and then a good ramp on to kindergarten through high school. But the majority of the communities in this country have not, and really are struggling with having to, you know, have both the sandwich generation figuring out elder care and child care. And I think that you're right, that we need to have a conversation. It creates a tremendous economic risk factor for us if we don't take care of that part. And the impact on our children, to your point earlier, around parents having to work 2 to 3 jobs and not be available to their kids after school to help with homework, to give the structure that children always need, is really a big problem. And they're all related. And we need to have a broader conversation and think about it as an investment in our families and in our children, and not something that I can get because, you know, I live in this community. I feel fortunate too. I mean, I'm from DC. I have a family. My kids were raised here and in Brooklyn, New York, and we always had basically what we needed to get by. But I also always knew that there were many, many people who were being left out.
It strikes me from a business perspective, you know, what businesses can do is they can have on-site child care for emergency mm-hmm. situations. Like, we actually have that. It's actually in our building, so yep. Your son would be in daycare and you could pop him off and pick him up and go down and see him. We have that. We did that pre-08 crisis, right? So those things exist. That's when you'll see that again now as people are competing to get more people. The bigger issue is how do you get that into public policy yep. issues when education is so locally controlled and locally funded by property taxes. I'm thinking of yep. New Jersey in particular. And also when you have limited income resources and you have competing interest as to where those funds are going to go. I mean, that's the daily battle, right? And what is it? A thorough and efficient education is what is supposed to be provided. But it doesn't say at what age that starts. So I think those are public policy. But the other thing to recognize is, where's the money coming from, right? And that's less of a corporate issue than that is really a public policy issue.
Good afternoon. My name is Nareya Kal, and I'm actually a captain in the Army. Ms. Slaughter, you spoke about men and their role in the broader movement. And Barbara, I found it interesting that you mentioned the necessity for women at the top to push women down on the line and ensure that they are afforded those positions and given the mentorship that they need. And the reason I mention my military background is that there are a lot of changes happening with regard to women in the military, but it's being driven by our male, white male leadership. And so, and this is by no means a criticism of your panel today, but there was one man here and there were no white men. And so I wonder, how do we engage that demographic, which really is the demographic at the top, to convince them that this is an important issue, because they're really the ones that have the influence?
Well, let me just start, because I was going to say this in response to the earlier question, that first, just a comment on the military, and then I'll turn to your question. But the military gets this more than most people. The military understands better than anyone else that if we do not invest in children 0 to 5, we will not have the people necessary to defend the country with the kinds of weapons they're going to need to be able to use for combat of the future. And so the military pays its early ed teachers the same amount as its K-12 teachers. It provides on bases the kinds of care things we need. And of course, the military is deploying women as well as men, and if they're deploying women, then it's men at home, assuming it's a heterosexual couple, And so they're thinking about this from the point of view of men more than women. So just as a general, I'm not going to say everything's perfect in our military, but I do think in response to how we frame this, I often say early education is a national security issue. It's an economic issue, and it's a national security issue. And then we need to talk about it that way, not a women's issue, but and not just a social issue, because that's broad and often code for women. It is a national security issue. It's a business issue. So with that point, I do think, I mean, we may not have had white men here. We have white men in the room. I'm looking at one of them who laughed heartily when you asked that question in the back there. But, you know, for one thing, Barbara said something important, which I think is also true, that men who are fathers, husbands too, but particularly fathers of, you know, women that they have invested in as fathers, but they've also, they're incredibly proud of their accomplishments and they see their, all their talent. And lo and behold, their daughter, you know, has a child, has a second child, and whoa, suddenly she's knocked out. And well, why can't you continue on that track? Well, you know, my partner, my firm, my whatever won't let me do it. That's a very powerful progressive force, in addition to the many white men feminists. I would not be where I am, but for men, two professors in particular, both of whom had working wives in the 70s and 80s, particularly in the 70s, and who really pushed women in the way many men did. So I do think that's a very important constituency. What I'd like to see, though, are many men of all colors and all income classes saying what you just said, which is we've liberated women in the sense that women can play both roles. They can be breadwinners and they can be caregivers and they can combine it. And I think it's just as my role as a mother is every bit as important to me as my role as a CEO, and that they're equal. I don't want to have to trade them off. Men don't have those set of choices.
I don't think you can use men's very competitive instincts which is to define the game differently. So what I did, and I was mentored by men, some fabulous men, is, and there will be, you will find it, but you've got to be at the very top. You've got to get to the CEOs or the guys, the first level report to the CEO to get change in your organization. Because in the muddy middle, people are still competing way too much to get to where they think they're going to get to, and none of them do, maybe one or two, but they're still believing. Right, men between the ages of 35 and 42 are particularly in competitive industries at a vulnerable, I call it dangerous phase, but it is for any number of reasons. But anyway, so that in that perspective, you get them older, wiser, wanting to make an impact. You can change things, but you turn it into a competition. Shouldn't we beat XYZ company? And so we should be more progressive in our policies. We can get those women back. Let's go beat so-and-so. They're going to take our side. If you use the language of the competition, you can actually unleash it and bring it forward. That's how we've made most of the changes, is on a competitive. And so it's the same thing as when you're selling. If you're selling a product or you're selling a service, you want to speak, read every speech the person has made that you're selling to, use their language so you're mirroring what they're doing, and you will find that they will buy. And that's what you're doing.
Just in response also to, I agree with all of that, in response also to the comment about males, white men in particular, where we've seen the most movement is inside of small businesses and medium-sized businesses. So the Main Street Alliance, which is an organization that pulls together small business owners across the country, and American Sustainable Businesses is another one. In those organizations, you see a lot of men who are business owners realizing that these are for competitive advantage sometimes, but also because they just think it's the right thing to do, that these are policies that they need to have inside of their businesses, and it's a part of their model for succeeding. And I think that the more they talk and the more that they bring other people on, when Seattle passed paid sick day, Seattle, Washington, it was a African-American woman restaurant owner who pulled together councils of business leaders throughout Seattle to talk about the bill and why it would be in their best interest to pass paid sick days in Seattle. It reduces turnover of staff, and for all the reasons we know. And if you're a restaurant, it's really a good business practice to be able to let people stay home if they're sick, because you don't want them serving food. So, I mean, she pulled these groups together. Many of them, majority of them were white men. But the part of the conversation, I completely agree with you, because we need to continue to have that conversation. We use that the same energy, and we also need to talk to that band of black men of all men in the middle that you refer to, the 35, 42-year-olds who are really striving for their careers, but also feel threatened enough in this economy, because that's the population of people who are voting at, like, who are saying 40% of the time or 30% of the time, yeah, these policies are really good for people, as opposed to 80 or 90% of the time, which is where women are and people of color. So I think that we need to have a conversation with men. Recently, there was a publication of a document, State of the World's Fathers. I don't know if anyone, State of the World's Fathers. It talked about men from all over the globe who were thinking about these issues in terms of culture change and public policy. And I think we're going to see change on that front over the years, but we need to begin having those conversations, and particularly with white men who are working class.
Well, it's, do you want one more question? Or, yeah, okay, one more question.
This brings, the idea of work-life balance is one that I work on every day, and I have thought a lot about this. A close friend of mine worked at an organization that had very progressive work-life balance policies. And when she was starting out, she often said that she wasn't getting recognition for the extra hours of work that she was in the office for, because it was common for people to just, you know, leave at 5 because they were mothers or fathers. But as we sort of, you know, research shows that people are having children later and later in life. So is there sort of a... And as millennials, I think I say this for myself, but I've realized with my friends that we're still sort of straddling the traditional notions of what helps to get you to a successful point in your career versus utilizing these new evolving conceptions of what makes a happier or better worker or workplace. So with that said, is there sort of a negative downside to increased flexibility, and does that sort of change how we define success? If you think that working extra hours will get you ahead when nobody recognizes it, is that going to change how we view our career trajectories?
So it's a good question. So my first answer would be, as I said, you know, I try to judge people on results. And so if you stay longer and work longer and do more as a result, that may advance you faster. But that's your choice. In other words, that's my point about intervals, right? You don't have to think that, you know, I want to hit my peak at 50. My view has always been, I hope I'm working till I'm 75 or 80. I like working. I don't want to burn out. But I also still want to have challenges, right? I still want to be thinking about the next thing. So the ideal to me seems to me, you can go as fast as you want. If you want to really, you know, there are people who want to work like crazy and hit a certain point by 10 years in. There may be others who prefer to, you know, have a more balanced life and progress more slowly, but critically still be eligible for advancing, whether at their current workplace or others. I would say, though, that if you're in a culture that really says, you know, look, get your work done, but have a life outside of it. You know, you're kind of a sucker if you're putting in work and nobody's recognizing it. Then that's probably not a great fit. You may need to apply to Barbara's career.
Well, we're performance based, so, yeah, you know, so you could be on the beach doing it. We don't care.
Well, thank you so much for coming. Thank you so much. A great panel. Thank you all for taking time out of your day to continue the conversation.
It's such a pleasure to meet you.